Welcome to Six Picks Music Club, a music podcast for people who are just so damn tired of it all. Well, here we are. It's another Wednesday, and here's another episode of Six Picks Music Club, the music podcast, where each episode we talk about six songs and do a little gymnastics to connect them to a theme. Thanks for being one with us and listening to each and every episode every other Wednesday on your favorite podcast, your favorite Pad Thai cast.
By the way, welcome everybody to Pad Thai Podcast. I just want to talk about one thing today, which is peanut sauce.
Big fan. I'll just say big fan.
It makes everything better.
Oh, that's a hard disagree. As
what?
No way. I don't touch it.
You have a nice Rama chicken with peanut sauce on it. Boom, boom, boom.
No.
Banging.
No. No peanut sauce ever.
No peanut sauce at all is what you're saying. You're opposed to it.
Yeah, zero. Never.
No, peanuts, not peanuts. Not peanut sauce.
Dude. It's like your taste buds and your earbuds are different than mine, you know? Like, yeah. It's just everything doesn't line up for us.
He doesn't like penis sauce. You like penis sauce.
Dave is going to make sure that no matter what happens, he gets the penis sauce joke in. I said it like four fucking times.
If I say it one more time, it's going to be funny.
But yeah, over here, we're just like, doing totally different bits and trying to save it. And you're just like, and by the way, you have the penis sauce. it's yours though.
But like how I said penis and not like a more crude word, I use the medical term. So, you know, that's what we do in our house.
Well, it's because it sounds like peanut. That's not.
Yeah, I guess that's fair. I wasn't trying to rhyme dick with peanut.
Yeah, what? So next, we're going to start talking about duck sauce. And got another chance here. Here it is. Dick sauce, right? Geoff wants some. Russ wants some.
Everybody wants to suck dick. Even me, especially me. I'm the most dick sucker of everyone.
That's true. So of the three of us, you are the highest probability of getting a dick in and around your mouth.
Thanks for being with us on this one and listening to each and every new episode every other Wednesday on your favorite podcast platform. Make sure you like and subscribe, share all the socials with your friends. But most of all today, we want you to just take a breath and give yourself some space to breathe. I'm Dave, and with me are my homies, Russ and Geoff. Howdy, boys. How are we doing today?
Well, man, we're trying to chill out. It's been intense lately, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, the last 8 weeks have been hectic emotionally. Yeah. Was that a fair hectic?
Chill that bitch out!
Yeah. So listener, today we're not going to get into any election stuff. We know you all have already been through enough of that. And, you know, there's likely still some bullshit to happen before the end of the year. So we'll see what happens. But today we want to just kind of like step back from the madness, from the CNNs, the MSNBCs and Fox's, BBCs, all of the news agencies, and just... Let's talk about some music.
That rhymed. Did you do that on purpose? Did you write that?
I didn't. That totally rhymed. He
said,
off the top of my fucking head, y'all.
Yeah, because you said the MSNBCs, the Foxes, and BBCs, something else, and the news and the other agencies. Like you, it could have been like an M&M flow.
The CNNs, the DOCs, the BBCs, the agencies.
Yeah. The Snoop D-O-double-G's in the group that said, motherfuck the police.
The BBC. Motherfuck the BBC.
Ice Cubes and BBCs.
Holy smokes. We're off to a great start, gang. But we should get in the clubhouse here. It's getting a little frosty around these parts. So what's our password today, Mr. Jeffro?
Free and fair erection?
I I hope they all are. Yeah, I hope they're all free and fair. Like once they start
taxing
my erections.
I want them to be free, and I definitely want them to be fair.
Definitely want them to be fair. But yeah, you charging me for an erection when there's all that Reddit porn? Come on. Okay, let's all get in there. Everybody find a corner. Don't sit too close. All right. Well, like we kind of talked about ad nauseum in our intro here, today's songs are songs that we picked that are just sort of, you know, let's calm it down a little bit. Let's chill the fuck out a little bit. And let's just kind of like step back from our lives that have been so crazy over the last, you know, 3, 4 months, 5 years, whatever it is. Like, let's everybody just cool out.
Yeah, the thesis of this ep is relax, man.
Just relax. We almost titled this one Chill Beach, but then I thought that, like, that's maybe going to confuse people about what we're trying to do here. It's really just about, like, you know what? Things have changed today, for better for some, for worse for some. And, you know, we're going to keep moving forward. At the end of the day, we're all here to, you know, live our lives. And whether or not you're trying to renew your passport right now or you know, finishing off the champagne that you toasted last night, you know, we're all here, we're all humans, and we're going to keep moving forward. Geoff, you kind of had an experience this recently that you wanted to kind of connect to it, right? I mean, we talked about this a little bit beforehand, but...
Yeah, I do want to talk about that. But first, I just want to ask you guys, where do you find your own music? So it's like, as I age, I love so much music. I love tons of bands. And I have a lot of vinyl records, not as many as you, but I have quite a few of them myself. But I still struggle when it's listening to music time. I often go like, what do I want to listen to? And become kind of paralyzed because it's almost like anything that you can conjure in your brain, you can listen to on streaming and everything. But that unlimited choice is actually paralyzing. Do you guys have that problem? Do you have like a way that you remind yourself of all the stuff that you listen to so that you can choose something?
Starting in 2020, I started making playlists for the year, like my 2020 playlist of like stuff, I mainly new stuff, but if there was something I hadn't heard in a long time, I'd add to it or so, roughly like 10, 11 hours of music. And then I made one in 2021 and then 2022, 23, and I'm mostly done with my 2024.
Still a couple of weeks left.
So what happens is I will pick a year randomly that I have these playlists from, and then I'll just start listening. And, you know, I like all the music on there, but they're really just like a giant mix of like different bands. And then if I find something like, oh, that sounds great, then I just deep dive into that. And then when I'm tired of that, I go back to one of those playlists, and then I just keep going until something sparks my interest, and then I dive down that one.
But how do you construct the playlist in the first instance? Do you do research or do you just kind of like...
I listen wide. I try to find new things, or I try to go and find bands that I like and go deeper down like their discography of things that I haven't heard to see if there's other stuff that I...
I do a lot of that. I do that. So I do like the chronological listen where I'll just start... from like I'll take a band that I like and listen from song one, album one, just to the bitter end, just to make sure I get the whole package.
Yeah.
But the playlist thing intrigues me because you're finding new stuff, but how are you finding the new stuff? And are you reading about it somewhere, or are you just following?
Sometimes I just like type in random ideas for like what I want to listen to, because people make their own playlists, right? So like I essentially just go scamming on a bunch of other people's playlists, listening for things I haven't found before. And
you're a real playlist maven. Like you're a playlist maker and consumer more than I am. Like I get given them sometimes by Spotify, and I'm like, yeah, I'll check it out. But I don't You are finding your way through the whole dense network of playlists and then rearranging and making your own. That's cool. That's a good use of the tech.
Yeah. No, I'm so old that I'm getting a colonoscopy next month, but I still check Pitchfork for a lot of new music and stuff that's coming along. Like I think they've got a pretty good staff there.
My question wasn't just about like new music. My question is, okay, I'm going to go sit in the living room or I'm in a DJ hanging out with my kids. What do I want to play here? And I often, though I love tons of stuff and have really gone like off the deep end on a lot of bands in my life, I will often in that moment blank because there's just too much. It's like limitless. Yeah. It's just a bunch of fucking songs swirling around and it's just an interface, you know, of limitlessness that's keying you in to this great vast expanse that's filled with millions of artists. Like, it's just so...
Yeah, no, I mean, it's an interesting thing because, like, technology's really started to curate stuff for you, right? As far as, like, what to listen to, I don't do a lot of streaming. Like, I'll do that in the car, like, but, like, I don't stream a lot at the house. So, like, that's only out of a specific necessity that I can't find something in the stacks that I want to listen to.
So this segues in. I know that was a very long entree into this, but it segues into the nature of our modern condition, which includes some what's happening in our politics now. Though I'm not going to get into this candidate, that candidate. I'm just going to talk about where we are as a society as a whole. But it's about fragmentation. So when I look at Spotify or whatever other streaming service there is, I just see fragmented art. It's like just, and what I was saying is it's so limitless and so unconnected from something that's like a movement or like a genre or being a scene. You remember there were music scenes and you'd be like, oh man, that band came out of New York. And like, you kind of listen to everybody in that scene to get a sense of what that was, or the punk scene, which was like a lot of stuff in a particular moment in time. Now there aren't really scenes. It's just like content that's being pushed at you. And then it and then it's gone. And then you're like, where is it? So that same thing is not just happening in music. It's happening across the board in our lives. And that fragmentation creates feelings of alienation, but also feelings that the world is more disordered because the things that used to order your world are no longer operating. And so, you know, you go back to your vinyl records, but you're the 1% of people that do that max, you know, and that's a solution to that problem of fragmentation. You're anchored in the material world of having those things, just like I want my CD book.
No, it's like physical media is a thing that connects me to all of it, whether it's like owning DVDs of my favorite films or, you know, I have two Sinead O'Connor cassette tapes that, you know, I ended up buying. I bought a tape deck to integrate into the stereo because, like, well, I've got these tapes. And now I got the Brad Sucks tape.
I have two Sinead O'Connor 8-track tapes. What?
They're cassettes.
No, I know. Just kidding.
I got rid of all my physical media.
Listener, you can't see how clean Russ's haircut is right now. He's on a mission from God, and he's looking real clean right now. And he's got no time for nonsense like a DVD cases or, you know, stuff that's going to have to get dusted.
Russ is doing a completely different, his response to that fragmentation. Either he doesn't feel the problem of the fragmentation, which is great.
Well, I think he's like found a solution to the fragmentation. Like he's invented a solution for himself, right?
Yeah, so the solution is to order that world. And you've created what amounts to like an algorithm to find your way through new music and playlists and all that stuff. You have like a sort of a method for getting through it. And I really just live in a space where I lack that method. And so I have to generate something. I, of course, have my vinyl records. I also read media and listen to radio stations and listen to Guy Garvey's thing. But I still have that paralysis when it's time to play the song. You know, what am I going to choose? The weight of this fucking decision, right?
Yeah.
In politics, that fragmentation exists. Like, political action is becoming more divorced from movements and connected to a community. There are still like some of those old organizations around, like the Teamsters and stuff, that are outwardly political organizations, but political association as a whole has gone down. And there's something else that gets ushered in to this whole thing in the modern, in the current feeling of fragmentation, which is the erasure of the future.
Yeah, tell me about that. What is that?
So I'm going to talk about this through the prism of three shows I've seen over the last week. It's been a show heavy time up here, and recklessly, though I'm so busy doing other stuff, I've been going to these shows. And so I went to Electric Light Orchestra last Monday. I went to the Saturday following that, I went to see St. Vincent. And then last night I went to see Phosphorescent. Okay. So,
dude, that's a great week, man. You got
a great week.
Yeah. I was excited when I saw two shows in a month and like one show every month of the summer, but three in one week. That's pretty great.
Yeah. That's kind of normally my speed, but it was just, this one was like, it's just a particularly busy time of good acts coming through. Yeah. So we have different responses to the fragmentation, but there's also this, what I mean by the erasure of the future is, people have stopped hoping for what is to come, which is usually connected to communities and political movements. Because we don't have a sense in music or in our politics that there's a movement that could usher in progress or could reshape the world in an interesting and hopeful new way. And I don't think that we feel that way about music. Like there's a new genre in the offing, or there's this like badass new thing that's happening in New York that we call rap. Like that, none of that is happening now. It's just like there's content that's being created, and it's just a pastiche of ideas that have come before. And there's nothing that's like a new musical movement. And there's also not really a new political movement. All the political movements are just new versions of old stuff. That combined with the things that are winning right now in politically are like basically politicians amplifying the fear that everybody has that the world is going to end. So on the left, what wins is the world's going to end because we're going to die heat death, or you know, a crazy person is going to take over the country and ruin it, and the whole country is going to collapse. This kind of like apocalyptic stuff that's on the left. On the right, the apocalyptic stuff is like people are coming into our country to destroy it. And if we don't do something now, we're going to cease to exist as America. You know, this kind of a thing. And on both sides, what that does is it creates a sense that there's no future. Right? There's no future with the people on the other side. And there's no compromise. I heard a Hyundai commercial call a car uncompromising. First off, Hyundais are not uncompromising. But also, why is that a good thing? Fuck something that's uncompromising. Compromise a little bit, you know? Hyundai?
Yeah.
Jesus. Anyway.
What if I don't want, you know, power sunroof? Can I get not power sunroof? Can we compromise, please?
It must be the Hyundai North Korea edition.
Shit.
Yeah.
Rattling the sabers over here, Mr. Russ.
So I'm gonna try to bring it back. I'm going to try to bring it back. But basically, with the erasure of the future and hope in what's to come, there are ways of dealing with that problem. One of them is to just go hard nostalgia. Just try to relive the past as hard as you can. And that was the ELO show.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
That was Electric Light Orchestra. I went specifically because my dad and I used to rock ELO together, and it gives me memories of listening to music with him when it was formative for me. And there are a couple of ELO records that I absolutely love, like El Dorado. I listened to in my Walkman. I had it on cassette. I listened to it on my Walkman the entire seventh grade year. I listened to that album 500 times that year. He's 76. This guy's one of the great songwriters, at least of the 70s, but maybe even in rock history as a whole.
Time,
he's got
I would say.
Tons of songs that you know about. But he was never like a famous front man, but he's a hugely important songwriter, producer, blah, blah, blah. He didn't really show his age all that much unless he had to walk or move or turn his body. And then you could tell that he was like a really, really old guy. But otherwise, They just propped him up in front of the microphone?
Unless he had to get out of the wheelchair, he looked pretty young. It's pretty good.
He was standing in front of the microphone and singing like he sang and playing the guitar, and it was all fine. And the graphics on their, like, their light show was incredible. And I was sitting in a chair on the floor because old people can't stand on the main floor. They've got to sit in chairs. And next to me was, like, a 70-year-old dude. I was like, he still got it, man, I'm telling you. And then on the right was a 60-year-old lady that just wanted to hear the disco Electric Light Orchestra, you know, the late 70s, early 80s stuff. Mm-hmm. And so when one of those would come on, she'd get up and dance, and then when he'd play like the old cello rock, the beginning Electrolyte, she would sit down. And so that was like a funny dynamic. But anyway, the thing about it is that those people are going to the ELO concert to remember to channel what it was like to be doing a ton of coke, singing about space, and thinking about the future together in the 1970s. Like, that's where people were back then, you know?
Right.
Like, handling their records, and and things are still up. This was a great concert, but it felt desperate. He's saying goodbye to everybody. It's called the Over and Out Tour.
Oh, well, it's his farewell tour, right? It's like the last time he's going to... So, yeah.
It's his farewell tour, but the fans had this desperate feeling about them because they're like... It just so, oh, I wish it was still like this stuff.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You know? Or is that the end for me, too? Like, if this is the end for him, like, how much left do I have? You know? Like, that's got to be a weird feeling.
Yeah, it's over, you know? That one was one response to the erasure of the future, is that you just go try to relive the past while you still can.
Like, you don't believe the future's possible anymore? Like, you've given up the dream.
You're not going to listen to music anymore. You're not part of any movement. It's just you just dig in your heels to what came before. That's the nostalgia response. Phosphorescent was last night. This is a guy our age who's got kind of an old soul. Like, he wants to be like Bob Dylan. He's worked with the director Paul Schrader. You know, he like spends a lot of time writing lyrics. This show was great, but he was like, I'm just going to warn everybody, from here on out to the very end, the songs are bummers. That's what he said. He's just like, they're bummers. And he had a song that's called The World Is Ending. And it's a beautiful song with really fascinating lyrics. But it felt like watching somebody play guitar while they're waiting for the Titanic to sink. Like, that was the energy of the show.
Damn. I would not go to that show. That is not the show I go to.
I think you would still like the music, but...
I'm not saying I wouldn't like the music. I'm just saying that I would not go to a show like that. That's not what I go to a show for. That's depressing.
Exactly. And so this is another response to the erasure of the future, which is to despair. And just to say, like, well, we're all going to die heat death anyway, so whatever. Fuck it. You know, that's another response, what he's doing, and he's doing it beautifully, but he's the last man. The third concert is St. Vincent, and I saw St. Vincent.
Annie Clark, dude.
Annie Clark from Tulsa and Dallas. I saw St. Vincent play probably in like 2005, 2004 or 5 when she was just starting out. And it was in Denton, Texas, and it was a great show, but it was like nothing like what she is now, which is,
dude,
off the charts. She is unbelievable. I don't even hesitate to say this. It's not hyperbole. Hands down, one of the best shows I've ever seen. It was amazing.
Oh, wow. No, that's awesome.
And it also says something about how we respond to the erasure of the future problem, which she's a woman that's our age, and her songs are about art and creation and action. She faces the darkness of the world, but she's saying, like, let's kick some ass. And she kept talking in the middle, in the interstices between the songs, about how we're all a community together. And she feels a kinship to all of us because she knows that we love art. She knows, you know, that we appreciate things like healthcare. Like, that was a joke, but it landed and everybody was like, fuck yeah. the show covered a lot of different genres. It was like kind of goth sometimes. Other times it was kind of glitzy. She spit while she was playing guitar on a couple of occasions. It had like a dangerous industrial feel sometimes. And then sometimes like a beautiful R&B feel. Like she was all over the place. Sometimes alien, sometimes really grounded. Just, it was an unbelievable, perfect show.
Oh, it sounds great.
That's another response to the Erasure of the Future, is that just like Camus wrote in The Myth of Sisyphus, what gets Sisyphus by? He's got to push a rock up a hill into perpetuity. What gets you by is knowing that that's still an act of creation. There's always action that we can take and creation that we can do. And I need, when it comes to picking music to DJ, I've got to get creative and I've got to take action. Maybe it's making better playlists. Maybe it's going back to the records and figuring out how to be a DJ again. But it requires work on my part rather than just despair or saying it can't be done. I'm going to give up on this streaming and this whole all this stuff forever, right?
So I was thinking about what you're saying in terms of like what I listen to. And I think maybe I know for sure that a lot of what draws me to punk rock is the idea of like challenging societal norm or some kind of issue that, you know, and facing it head on and then just like essentially calling it out to then figure out an action to take to overcome it or rise against it or something like that, right? Which brings me to Rise Against. You go see a Rise Against show. And yes, it's punk rock, and yes, it's fun, and yes, it's very like social driven, if you will. But in between songs, when Tim McElrath is addressing the crowd, it's almost like he's like a preacher in a church or something, or like a leader of some kind of congregation. And then the way he talks about the crowd as a whole, and then like almost brings everybody together. And you know, there are people there that just would not get along. But in those shows, in between songs, like it feels like one giant community moving to possibly into some kind of action that can actually better the future. And I feel like those shows are so hopeful. And we're seeing them again in November, because I will watch Rise Against any time, because there's a feeling you get when you go to one of those shows that is just, yes, they talk about the stuff that is not good, but they also, you have this feeling of hope that comes with it, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
No, that's important.
Bringing it back to Annie Clark, right? So it's interesting that you like that kind of grungy piece of it too, because what is it? Dave Grohl plays drums on Annie's most recent single that has like this whole Nine Inch Nails kind of inspiration. Yeah. Like, yeah. It's super dark. Well, and Rise Against as well, you know, like this idea that we need to be pushing forward. I feel like it's interesting because like in modern music, it feels like there's such a homogenization of styles because everything is blended together. You get rock and hip hop in the same breath and, you know, R&B and
everything has become a pastiche. That's what I was saying. Like, and this happens with political ideas. Like, we don't have a new new item on the menu. It's all just, is this fascist? Is it communist? Is it capitalist, liberal? Like, you know, everything is a prepackaged idea. There's no new vision for society. And similarly, music, everything is just a recombination of things that you've already heard before.
Yeah.
With some rare exceptions. And we're often drawn to those exceptions because, and I think St. Vincent is singular. Like, she's a virtuosic guitar player that's doing various types of music, but that is all very vital somehow. Like, her music has a sense of vitality to it that is kind of like unexplainable to me, but it's there. It's the way that you feel, the way I feel when I listen to her is the way I feel when I listen to Prince. Do you know what I mean? Where you're like,
oh, yeah, yeah.
There's a bit of mystery to it, but you're like, God, dude, yes. Like, this is so.
The prowess of their talent is just.
Yeah, there's so much talent here, but it's also catchy as shit. And like, I want to listen to it with other people because it's interesting.
I love everything about this. Yeah, 100%.
So, yeah, all that vitality is what made that ultimately the best out of those shows. Because it's like an answer. It's like a way forward. And she's trying to bring everybody along with her. Not saying goodbye. Oh, we should relive the 70s. And not saying like, the end of the world's coming, so fuck it. She's like, no, let's go get it, dude. We can make art.
Yeah, I like that.
You know?
Yeah.
I like that a lot.
No, that's awesome.
So great. And that's what we also need to do politically. We need to say we can make the future together. We can make the future together still. You know? There is a future. Humans will stay around for a long time. And so
yeah.
Not everything is going to be defined by what happened in the year 2024, right? There's more time to work on this. And that's the that's the message.
Ever forward. Right, Russ? Isn't that the way?
That's it, man.
Well, listen to us talking politics when we said we weren't going to talk politics, but...
I don't think that we were talking politics. I think we were talking about...
I got into politics a little bit.
It's not a partisan thing. It's not a partisan message. It's a message about our political condition, Dave.
I believe you because you're the doctor.
You're the doctor of penis sauce.
Penis sauce. He did it. He went, got back to the penis sauce, guys. It's an unbelievable callback.
I knew it was going to work.
I don't know how he did it.
Unmatched callback.
Such skill. All right. Well, back to our idea that... You know, there is a future out there, and we may not be able to see it right in this moment. And rather than get too stressed out about what the hell is all going to happen, I think today is the day to just sort of chill out. Let's chill the fuck out. Everybody relax. Everybody bring it down. And you know what, Geoff? I really like your first track here tonight, so I'm going to let you take the lead on this.
We chose songs that are about, like, just taking a chill pill, you know? Everything's tomorrow, like as they say in Gone with
Going where? Huh?
Excuse me, what was that?
Going back to Cleveland?
As they say in Gone with the Wind, tomorrow's another day. And my song for that is based on an old Christian hymn written in 1931 by Eleanor Fajon, who lived in East Sussex. Do you want to know any
more
about
we get it.
Her? No, the song is...
No, shut up.
No, and play shut it. Up about it. The song is Morning is Broken by Cathew Stevens off of the record Teaser and the Firecat in 1971. It achieved the sixth spot on the top 100, this one.
Morning has broken like the first morning, blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from.
No, man, I feel really relaxed after listening to that track, dude. Feels like a new day. It feels like there's a little bit of sunshine coming
up. It's a song about renewal. Do you think it's funny to pretend that his name was Cathew Stevens? Does anybody else think that's funny? I've always called him Cathew Stevens, like I'm saying his full name. but I think I'm the only person that thinks it's funny, and that's fine. Anyway, this is a great song. I always thought that this was I think the first time I heard it was in Catholic church, and so I just thought it was like is in the religious songs book that the band would play in Catholic church, and so I just thought, and it is a religious song, but I didn't realize that Cat Stevens had performed this version of it until later in life, and I was like, what is that? What is that? Where did that happen? And so, you know, a former altar boy that figures out that rock can do it better, or like a truly great musician can handle this song better than the Catholic church band. But this is such a beautiful thing.
Yeah, it turns out like professional musicians are better singers and musicians than the church choir who meets on Tuesday.
Interesting dude, Cathew Stevens. You know, he wrote Peace Train, and then he almost drowned to death and went hardcore you know, religious conversion and changed his name to Yusuf Islam, and then didn't really play the same kind of music anymore until very recently he started doing it again.
Do we address him as Cat Stevens or Yusuf Islam? What's I know he's known by both, but like what's
his name is Yusuf Islam. It's like you don't call Muhammad Ali Cassius Clay anymore. He's Muhammad Ali.
Right. But when we talk about his music, we talk about the music that was released as Cat Stevens.
Oh, I see what your question is. Yes, when the song was released, it was a Cat Stevens song. Okay. That's the name of the artist. And so you would still refer to it that way.
Okay.
Just like if you were going to go to an old Muhammad Ali boxing match where he was fighting Cassius Clay, you would not change his name backward to Ali versus Liston or whatever. It would be Clay versus Liston still, because that's the name of the fight.
So why did you pick this, though? Like, why did you say, like, yeah, no, I know you wake up wishing you had...
And I could just look out on nature and notice that the blackbird has spoken like the first bird. I wish that I could do that in the morning. Instead of, Dad! Dad, I shit my pants! It's like, morning has broken. Dad's back is broken. Like the first dad's back. Anyway, yeah, so I picked this
growing
song because...
Growing a tumor it is a inside my brain.
Jesus. High on the list of fears. top five fear for your boy, brain tumor. Or even worse is the aneurysm. Because the aneurysm, you didn't do anything wrong. You just are walking around. Oh, I have a splitting headache. Oh no, that's just that's just a clogged up vein in your brain that's about to explode and you're gonna die. How about that? Oh, cool.
Just snake eyes. You're done.
Snake eyes. Bad snake eyes.
Hey, am I crapped out?
It's an extension of our topic from earlier. I think if we could all somehow as a political community come to the realization that we've got to wake up to a new morning and renew our bonds, that would be a great thing. I don't really know how to make that happen, but that's what this song is about, you know, reconciling through a new day, renewal, you know, starting over, a refreshing. You know, all that stuff, all the good stuff. And it really does make me feel chilled out. Like, I definitely want to sit on the porch and look at nature when this song comes on. Like, it immediately takes me to that space.
With a hot cup of coffee?
Yeah.
Yeah,
yes.
For sure. It's always the thing, like, you know, we talk about being dads and stuff. And you know, when kids make mistakes, when they fuck up, like, you know, you still got to let them know. Like, hey, this is a... We don't do it like that. Like, that's not the way. Like, this is a mistake, and you're going to learn from this, and tomorrow you're going to do it different, you know? Tomorrow you're going to get to be a better version of who you are today, and I think, like, that's a great kind of philosophy to structure your mental headspace around. So, all about it. All about this one.
I like it. I like it. That's good. Yeah, I mean, you know, I think my kids were... I just want to go back to what you're saying real quick. My kids, we have to, like, really pound into them, like... Grown-ups make mistakes. Like, we make mistakes all the time.
Right.
They're like, no, you know. I was like, seriously. So I always call out when I fuck something up. I'm like, I fuck that up. Look what happened. Okay.
Yeah. I often admit mistakes in front of the kids too. Yeah.
I don't know. Like, and I think it's important. I'm like, well, what did I learn from this? Like, okay, well, if I walk away from the stove for too long, I burn the eggs or whatever. You know, I mean, like, and so now I know not to do this. Like, every mistake is just a learning experience that we can, where we can be better. And I think it's important. And then they're like, oh, okay. And then you can just start seeing them not be like... My daughter would get very hard on herself when she makes a mistake, but just ever so slightly, she's just like less hard on herself when it happens now. Because like, okay, well, we just know not to do it next time. You know, I don't know. It's just one of those things.
That happened right before the pod, the number two came down, and he goes, hey, you forgot to turn on the ocean, which is the background noise we play in their room.
The sound machine.
And I was like, you're right, dude. I did forget that. My bad. Let's go fix it. Instead of being like, you forgot it, you little douche. Don't tell me I made a mistake.
Why is it my responsibility? It's your fucking room, you idiot.
Yeah.
Where's my
get
belt?
Get it together. Yeah. I'm going to spank that ass.
Go get a switch from the tree. If it's too small, you'll have to get another one.
You have to get another even bigger switch. I'll choose a switch after that. It'll be a big switch.
Gosh, God, we turned into Detroit Lions running backs there for a second.
You know what I find really annoying about our podcast is whenever I hear myself laughing in the microphone. When I'm listening back to an episode, I'm like, stop fucking laughing. Like, I get so pissed off myself for laughing. I'm just naturally laughing at the conversation, though, listener. It's not, I'm
we're
sorry.
Having a good time. I feel like a lot of things are funny. And if you think I'm over laughing,
I mean, he has spit his drink out 3 times in the last 10 minutes.
There, I have noticed a couple of spit takes, I'm like, man, my shit is so fucking funny, but it's really just Dave's thinking about boobs and laughing.
They're so funny to me. I love a boob. But yeah, no, I think let's take these positive vibes, you know, this renewal, and then Russ, how do we transition to you from renewal to what?
Okay, so I'm going to take a bit of a different direction here. I'm going to go with a song called Grand Optimist.
Sounds positive.
By City and Color off of the 2011 album Little Hell.
Oh, that's less positive.
Then there's my father. He's always looking on the bright side, saying things like, son, life just ain't that hard. He is the grand optimist. I am the world's poor pessimist. You give him burdens sometimes, and he will escape unscarred.
Bear with me for a moment. This song is a bit of a journey for me. But before we get there, quick question. Do you have a middle name, Geoff?
Yeah.
One?
Yeah.
One middle name? Dave?
One middle name.
Yeah, one middle name.
Okay, I only have one middle name as well. My brother-in-law has two. Old Dallas Green, who is the songwriter here, he says that when he was born, he didn't have a name for a while, like... They didn't name him for a little bit. Yeah. I'm not sure how long. But when he finally did get named, his name is Dallas Michael John Albert Green, which is awesome.
Sounds
That's
like
a lot of names.
Pretty indecisive parents right there. Well, just call them everything.
Anyway, so Dallas Green is a singer and rhythm guitarist and songwriter for the post-hardcore band Alexis on Fire, and City and Color, which is what this band is, or this project is his solo project, which he was doing in between Alexis on Fire tours. And then when Alexis on Fire disbanded in 2011, he decided to do City and Color full time. Fun fact, City and Color comes from his own name. So Dallas a city and Green a color, right? So.
Aha! Finally we cracked it.
All right, so Dallas has made it abundantly clear through his music that he struggles with anxiety. He is the epitome of stressed out and someone who constantly worries about everything all the time. Like, the dude just cannot relax.
Dude, I know a lot of people from Dallas that struggle with anxiety. Yeah, it's a real pandemic up there.
So I think he makes...
In Dallas, Canada?
Is there a Dallas, Canada?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know. Cool. Maybe. Yeah. Maybe it's Dallas is everywhere. Anyway, Russ, Dallas has anxiety?
Yes. Like I have anxiety now.
Oh, jeez. Russ is like, Jesus fucking Christ.
He goes trying to chill out and can't do it, getting all up on edge, man. Goddamn. Anyway, yeah, he can't relax. I can't relax. So it's all too many fucking interruptions in his life and in my life, I think. So I think he makes this kind of chill music to help him do that. Alexis on Fire is exact opposite, right? It's like super hard, it's fast, it's aggressive. So if I'm feeling stressed out or on edge or fucking angry, I can put this song on and it works on a few levels, right? One, the music, it's somber and chill, even though the first 90 seconds is only acoustic guitar, you still have like that definitive beat that's going through. And then when the chorus kicks in, you get those strings and that tambourine and that big drum hit that goes through, which is kind of fun.
No, that's a good moment in that track for sure.
And then secondly, it's the lyrics, right? So Dallas is in way worse shape than I am, no matter what is happening in my life. And I don't want to say I'm profiting off his misery, but it really helps to put things in perspective. And by the time that song's over, like, I just want to be the father in that song, the grand optimist. I do not want to be the poor pessimist. And it's already started putting me on the path of like having chilled out, having figured out where I need to be going and not get stuck in like and dwell on whatever is happening.
Yeah.
Whoa.
So it's like a
Alexis on fire. Right? Is that what their music? No, I'm sorry.
I don't think that's no, but it's like it's what is it, a morality tale or something? It's kind of like you know, these two roads. You can pick which way you want to go, and I think there's an interesting thing to that mindset, you know, like being able to identify the kind of person you want to be, being able to say like being able to just even see like I can go down this path, but what is it? How does it serve me? Right? Like, it's what I hear you saying. Is that, am I hearing that right?
Right. Right. No, that's it. That's like, because I think when I start, let's say I'm at the point when I'm like, I should need to chill out or cool out or whatever. I am not thinking like, I want to be like this grand optimist. I want to be this, like I want to be pushing forward. I want to be stuck in a, whatever, in the hole I dug. I want to be pissed off, or I want to be upset, or whatever it is. And I don't really like to be there. And so it's kind of helpful to see both sides of things and be like, oh yeah, I need to like go this direction.
Yeah. No, there is something that's like oddly sort of captivating about sort of living in your misery or whatnot. Like, there's so many people that are like, I don't want to say driven to that, but it's an interesting thing where, you know, how is it serving you? Like, what is it doing for you? Like, you're holding on to all this anger and regret or hate or whatever it is. And it's paralyzing you from doing that forward motion, from being able to kind of make a choice or do something differently.
Yeah, honestly, despair porn is kind of in now, you know, where like people... And I don't mean like actual porn. I just mean.
No, right.
It's like, oh, everything is miserable. And like, yeah,
no.
Yeah. Understood.
It's like emotionally pornographic for sure.
I really wish you could take people that are like that and put them in a time machine back to like 1820 and be like,
oh my God, if we could take Morrissey and put him back to 1820, Jesus,
now you're fucking miserable.
Take you back 200 years, dude.
Yeah, and you have to go to the dentist when you get there, okay?
They're going
to
bleed and you.
Yeah, now you're fucking miserable. Yeah.
Here's a shot of whiskey, and then I'm going to pull your tooth with these pliers.
Yeah, exactly. Like, what was so bad about living in 2024? Oh,
yeah, you haven't got a home? Well, now you really don't got a home, because homes don't exist yet. Go make a mud hut. I don't know what part of the world we're sending Morrissey back to in 1820, but
right. Sometimes I do this talk where I show people what the causes of death were in like the middle 17th century in England, because they would have like a roster of how people died. And one of the ways that they died that killed a bunch of people is just called teeth. they died of teeth. That's real.
So it's not just like a stereotype?
Yeah. No, they, how did he die? Just teeth, man. You know, it was just another teeth one.
Teeth got him.
Teeth got him.
He was so strong, yeah. But teeth, it came out of nowhere and teeth got him.
And it's like, it's funny now, but people did just die of teeth. like they got tooth decay and, yeah, tooth decay, infection, sepsis. Yeah. And so you die of, yeah, you die of your
jaw,
your
falls off,
face rotting from your,
wow,
teeth up.
Straight to the brain and dead.
Yeah.
God. how bad do you smell when you, like, your breath? Oh.
And then you got to go to prom with that guy and he's trying to kiss you. And it's just like, ugh.
Such a weird direction to take that.
You're gonna die in 6 months. Do we really have to dance this close?
It's like Buffy the Vampire Slayer, but the instead of a vampire, the guy has tooth decay.
Russ, is this just like a reminder to, it's like, oh, like, consider chilling out, or does this song actually chill you out?
The music itself, I think, is somber. So, like, it, I think the music hits on the emotional level of just, like, being able to kind of decompress or calm down or whatever it is. Like, when those strings come in the tambourine and the big drum hit, I feel like you kind of get absorbed by it. Like, almost like if you could get hugged by music, maybe that's kind of that moment.
Yeah.
Musically, I think it helps calm me down. And then once I've calmed down enough, I feel like I can start thinking about things and just being like, well, the shit I just went through isn't nearly as bad as, like,
could be worse.
Yeah, right. Could be worse. So it puts me in a different perspective. And then I just start kind of inching my way toward coming out of the hole that I'm in.
That's cool in that music, the bass, whatever synth rises up in that thing, whatever that.
Yeah, that's a great review there, Geoff. Thanks so much. Anyway, we're going to move along from his scholastic opinion of the bass, was it?
All right, what's your fucking song? Hey, Big Shot, what's your big fucking song? What's your big time fucking song that makes you feel strong? Let's go.
Okay. Like, we're supposed to be chilling out, guys.
All right. Okay. Let's do a box breathing exercise. So we're going to breathe in for a count of four, hold for a count of four, breathe out for four, hold for a count of four.
You should never breathe into a box. You can kill them that way.
Oh, God.
Just eat the box. Oh, I saw a thing just real quickly. Where it's like people that are taking those kind of live, laugh, love signs and putting them in different places of their house. And so the one that's like in the kitchen for the ice cream area that says, life is short, lick the bowl. They put it in the bathroom.
Oh, that's funny.
Which I thought was fantastic.
That's pretty good.
And so my wife was like, what are some other things that we could change and like put in different weird places? Like, okay, in the bedroom, let's like, you know, grab a plate and eat up.
That's so gross.
Chow down.
So gross to me.
Why is that gross? Just chowing down?
Yes.
Poor wife of yours.
I don't...
Gosh, give her some attention, man.
You guys are like brothers and sisters. I don't want to think about you chowing down on her plated veg. That's gross. Or like your junk on a plate and she's licking it. Yuck. It's the worst.
It's my dick in a box.
I hate both of those ideas so much.
Let's take a break and chew the fat. Play that motherfucker.
Geoff, Russ, and Dave in the motherfucking chat. Chewing the fat on stuff weird and whack.
All right, since we're trying to chill out, and this episode is going to be every bit of fucking 4 hours long, let's go on a tangent real quick. You got 2 seconds. Best insult in middle school. Go.
You're like, I bet you jerk your dad off. Oh, my God.
What do you say to that? Oh, no, I don't. Like, it's, yeah, the damage is done.
It is a perfect attack line. It's a perfect attack line. Yeah. What? What's that? What's that? White socks and sandals? I bet you jerk your dad off.
Oh, my God.
He's like, all I was saying is that tattoos are cool. I didn't know it was going to be scorched fucking earth.
God.
Reebok right. Pumps.
Yeah, dude, just crushing a kid.
And now back to Six Picks Music Club.
On to the next song.
On to the next song. So yeah, for my song, I picked a song that I love off a record that I really love. This is from the 2014 album by the band Spoon. It came out on August 5th of 2014. The album's called They Want My Soul, and this is a song called Inside Out.
Time's gone inside out.
Spoon also did the very best pandemic record.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good one. The
Lucifer on the Sofa. It's like the best interpretation of the pandemic. Some of the like the songs on that about walking around right. Austin just with a pack of smokes and trying to figure out like what the hell's going on, and just such a like, oh. Anyway, that's not what this is.
Yeah. No. I'm glad we finally got Jeffro turned around on Spoon, because for the longest time he bemoaned them a bit. And
I did.
Glad we got to see the light.
I did come around, and you know what? I think I think honestly, it was this song. This is the song that began
really?
My transformation to a fan of Spoon from an openly non fan of Spoon. Like, I was not only did I not like them, but I was kind of against them.
Okay, so after hearing this, going back and listening to their older stuff, how did that change or influence your opinion of their older
records? I haven't
really
listened to their older records, funnily enough. I listened to
so this record
one
and
forward,
going forward?
Yeah,
or?
And I like all this stuff pretty good.
Okay.
But maybe I should go listen to that older stuff. There was something that wasn't connecting about the early stuff with me. And I don't know what it is. I think
I have an idea about it, though. Do you want to hear?
Yeah.
This record was produced by Dave Friedman. It was the first album that he produced for Spoon, and then he would go on to produce their next record, Hot Thoughts. And Dave Friedman's an interesting person in the music world, because he kind of got started in that band Mercury Rev.
Oh yeah, I like Mercury Rev.
He played with them, and through that he got connected to the Flaming Lips. And he produced the Flaming Lips record in a priest-driven ambulance. He produced that record for them in 1990. And then he produced every other record of the Flaming Lips's save for Transmissions of the Satellite Heart. That's the only record of theirs that he was not the producer on.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He's also produced records for Mogwai, for Sparkle Horse. He did the It's a Wonderful Life record for Sparkle Horse, which we've talked about before.
So we have an accomplished wide-ranging producer on board.
Slater Kinney, The Woods, did MGMT, Tame Impala, OK Go.
That's a lot of skins on the wall. Let's make sure that we list every single one of them, though. Let's not finish until we get to them.
Okay, but like, he's legitimately referred to as the Phil Spector of indie rock music. So like, that's who he is, right? With some of those accolades, I think he brings a different sound to this record. Mm-hmm. And it's also funny, there's a really good Song Exploder episode about this track.
I think Dave was trying to box breathe while he was saying that.
Thanks for interrupting it, you dick. Obviously. So there's also a Song Exploder episode about this track, and Britt Daniels, lead singer of Spoon, talks on the idea of kind of the beats from Dr. Dre's Chronic 2001 influencing how he wanted the beats on this album to sound, which is really interesting. And Jim Eno is the drummer of Spoon, and he drums everything live. So it's kind of fun to see how music touches music, even on down. I really like this album, and I really like this record because it does chill me out. It's got a whole lot of just sort of really introspective elements, from like the ethereal sounding things to just the lyrics, man. It's like this cyclical, nonlinear perception of time, past, present, future. They're all interconnected. It's like time's inside out. It's all the same. You know, I'm a stranger in a strange land, feeling alienated, being disconnected. And it's just like, I don't know, for the last 10, 12 years, I feel like that's how a lot of people have felt. And you know, there's still a lot of people that are going to continue to feel that way for the next number of years. And I just think that we do have to keep moving forward. We do have to keep, you know, staying true to ourselves. And it's funny that this record is titled They Want My Soul, which is like this kind of rejection of like everything that the music industry is going to take. It's like they want it, but they're not going to get it. And it's pretty awesome. So if you haven't heard this record, listen to it in its entirety. But I like it a lot.
So what you're saying, though, about Friedman is that I obviously am sensitive to production value. And so when I heard this record, I could hear how good it was produced. And so I was like, okay, you guys are stepping up, so maybe now I can listen to your stuff.
Or it's just sounded more similar to other things that you already liked. And he was bringing that kind of stuff into Spoon. And you're like, oh, I can get into this now because I like this and that, which are things that maybe he was doing in other...
Oh, I didn't realize Spoon was such a Flaming Lips band. That's pretty awesome. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's some of that. I mean, obviously there's like a production value that's highlighted through all of the music that he's done. It's not by mistake that they call him the Phil Spector of indie rock, because he brings so many different elements into just the scope of it. So it's big, it's full, it's got elements that you know you don't get on Spoon Records really before this. It's also interesting that, like, if you look at where there are turning points for bands, like, I think he was nominated for a Grammy for The Soft Bulletin by the Flaming Lips.
Oh, really?
And that was a turning point where they started to change and develop their sound, right?
Oh, yeah. They're totally different from that record on. Yeah, for sure.
So from Soft Bulletin to, you know, Yoshimi to War of the Mystics, he actually won the Grammy for producing War with the Mystics. At the Mystics? No, it's with the Mystics.
At War with the Mystics, I think.
But yeah, the Mystics got fought and we're at war. And Friedman won the Grammy for that album.
So that's cool. That guy, yeah, maybe that guy's my hero. And because every single thing that you've listed that he's been involved with, I like.
You didn't list the 2017 album that Geoff, I think, is probably your favorite.
Penis Sauce.
That's right.
I knew it was coming. I knew it was like coming, dude. I could tell by how serious you got.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I, you know, again, hometown hero, living in Austin, getting to see Spoon become the band that they become over the years of still being just themselves and running into them at bars and whatnot. It's been cool to see. So
that's awesome, man.
It always chills me out. And perfect song for today. We are going back to Jeffro for pick number 4 in our 6 picks of... Guys, everybody calm down. Let's just chill out for a minute.
Oh, my, was that, okay, sorry, I was confused.
Geoff, what, this is where you pick up the phone and tell people that you're here.
Yeah, my second song is by Stevie Ray Vaughan off the 1991 record, The Sky Is Crying. It's called Life by the Drop.
Hello there, my old friend. Not so long ago, it was still the outside in the pouring rain. On our way up the road, we started over again. You're living our dreams, oh, you on top. My mind is aching, Lord, it won't stop. That's how it's happened, living life by the drop.
All right, so are you saying we all should be getting wasted right now? Just
that's not what the song's about. Anyway, so we're the first song.
But you don't drop alcohol, you drop acid.
Yep.
Yeah.
Then you drop trowel.
Oh. But you're not taking a drop of alcohol. That's not what it's talking about.
It could be a veiled reference to that. So the song was written by Stevie's buddy, childhood friend, Doyle Bramhall, who is also a musician. So the words are actually written about Stevie, but Stevie's performing the song. But his old buddy Doyle wrote.
Oh, it's kind of meta.
And so it is kind of meta, and he's saying, like, you've gotten to such great heights. And Doyle was famous, but never to Stevie Ray Vaughan's level, who was, like, uber for a minute there. He, of course, recorded this song, and then he died in a helicopter accident not too long after, and it was released posthumously. And it's, I think, the last song on the record, The Sky Is Crying. Which is a great record overall. Like, it was maybe his best work, and it's the posthumous record. But where the first song is about renewal, this one's about reconnection, which is, you know, it's old friends that used to walk together and talk about the blues, and then they kind of drifted apart, and now they're coming back together, and they're walking and reliving old times and thinking about singing the blues again, you know? So it's just like drifting apart and coming back together. And I think that's a really hopeful thing in general, but also this song really chills me out. And so I remember I had a buddy from Sweden in New Orleans one time, and there was a band that played a cover of this, and I just was like melted on the floor. There was like five people at the whole show, and I was like, oh my god, yeah. Like, I felt so good in that moment. There's just something about it, it's like really gets me feeling good in kind of a hypnotic way right away.
When I think about Stevie Ray Vaughan, I think about that movie, The Enormous Weight of Unbearable Talent, or what is it, The Unbearable Weight of Enormous Talent.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Maybe with the other way.
Nicolas Cage movie.
But it's just like, yeah.
That's a funny movie.
Not in that, like, there at all. It's a funny movie. But just the title of it is just sort of like, that is who Stevie Ray Vaughan is to me. He's just like this, I don't know, this virtuoso of, I mean, we were talking about Annie Clark earlier or whatnot, but like, Annie Clark doesn't fly without Stevie Ray Vaughan running, right?
Yeah, I mean,
is that fair to say?
Yeah, and I mean, he was a preternaturally gifted musician. Like, he was basically the Mozart of blues guitar, if that could exist. Like, he was the, like, nobody will ever be able to play like that again, as far as I can tell, you know? Some of the music, though, would, you know, I don't love all of Stevie Ray Vaughan's music, just because it's so, like, guitar-centric, and that it's kind of outmoded now, but there's some of them that are still so goddamn good that it's like,
I feel the same way about Hendrix. I'm just like, so much guitar.
All right.
I'm like, can you like let anybody else have a moment in the sun, guitar guy? What the fuck are you saying? Shut up.
It's not stupid. It's not, what I said wasn't stupid.
Stevie Ray Vaughan is too guitar centric.
No, it's just like
Stevie Ray Vaughan.
Like, let's just write a great chorus and have a good catchy song. Like, it doesn't have to be just, but he's, it's like listening to Joe Satriani sometimes. Like, you don't listen to Joe Satriani records, you know that he's a great guitarist.
Oh, fuck you. Fuck you, it is. No fucking way.
I said
fuck
sometimes.
You. That's totally,
I'm the one that picked the fucking
base.
Song.
That's so
I love
base.
Stevie Ray Vaughan. I'm just saying sometimes.
You can't put Stevie Ray Vaughan in the same conversation with Joe Satriani. That's ridiculous.
Dude, we're supposed to chill, guys. We gotta chill out. God damn.
No, I'm not chilled out anymore. Now I'm arguing in the bar with Dave about Wilco.
All right, all right, all right. Box breathing. 2, 3, 4.
Let's renew. Let's renew and reconnect. Four. Let's show the people, Dave, how we can reconcile.
You're right. You're right. No, let's model the behavior we want to see in the world. This is like, it's not a day for arguing. This is a day about renewal. Okay.
I hear what you're saying. I hear what you're saying, Dave. I hear what you're saying, that they can't be compared. But I feel like you should also hear what I'm fucking saying, which is...
which is nothing compares to you.
Bringing it back to Prince.
Yeah. I like that.
Yeah. I just want to commend you guys on turning it around and being reasonable. We need that.
Yeah. You know, like a couple of people just like totally like not trying to shit in each other's mouths.
Oh my God. Oh, no.
The episode is called Chill the Fuck Out. in parentheses, just kidding.
And we are not doing that. It's just very aggressive in here. I blame me.
But yeah, hey, Dave, sorry. I forgot to finish this off. Life by the drop might mean kind of living life in an unbearably light way. You know, it's just you take it as it comes. It's just like one random walk, you know, and it's unpredictable. But it might also mean, you know, you're an alcoholic and you lost touch with your buddies because you're too busy, like, doing coke and drinking for seven.
So did he crash the helicopter himself?
No. It was like he had actually gotten.
Did he get shot down?
Shot down.
No,
he had gotten clean, man, and so he was like he was on his ascent back up. Like he had really gone off the deep end, I think, like where he was drinking just to not feel sick, you know. And he had stopped all that stuff, and his career is about to take off again. And he was playing in some like shithole in Wisconsin, and it was a foggy night. They left at 1 a.m. and the helicopter pilot just ran into a hill. Like it was called controlled flight into terrain is the way they referred to that. Kobe? Yeah, it is a Kobe situation. It was basically a Kobe crash. Like the pilot fucked up in the fog and drove him into the ground. And so they got hurt real bad. They got killed real hard.
They got hurt dead. Yeah. Real hard.
And the crazy thing is that there were four helicopters. The other three helicopters made it to where they were going. Jimmy Vaughn was on one of those. And they didn't even know that the fourth one had crashed because it was so foggy outside. Until they got to where they were going, they were like, "Where's Stevie's helicopter?" And it was all the way back.
Ugh,
yeah,
that sucks.
Heartbreaking.
That's really sad.
Well, he's a hometown hero, and I definitely love Stevie Ray Vaughan, and I can't calm down after that. I can't calm down.
We should listen to Life by the Drop together in person, and then that'll fix it.
A grid. Everything's better in person, gang, just so you know, which is why we are now offering for the grand low price of $1,000 the opportunity for you to come sit in the studio that you will rent for us. And then pay for our airfare to come together to record a podcast together. So
yeah, and for $2,000, they get to sit on your lap, right, Dave? Or is it that you pay $2,000? I can't remember the pricing.
I've been married for almost 15 years. I don't pay for stuff
for
like
pussy
that.
On a plate in your bedroom or whatever.
Grab your bag. It's on. You know what I'm saying?
Gross.
So gross. Last thing I want to say about the Life by the Drop thing, maybe it's about savoring things. Maybe it's about like actually, you know, appreciating every last drop of things. Not a Folgers commercial, but kind of maybe Folgers stole it and said like, we'll make your song our thing now.
That's a cool way to look at it. I like it. At least for the sake of this episode, let's go with that.
Let's take a break. Everybody go drain your penis sauce and refill your beverage, and let's do some pod swap.
No, I'm talking about pod swap.
Do you love music? Do you want to explore classic albums? If you answered yes, then check out Polyphonic Press. I'm Jeremy, and along with my co-host John, we rely on the patented random album generator to pick an album for us to review. At the top of each show, we have no idea what album we're going to be listening to. That's what keeps it really exciting. We dig real deep into these albums. So if this sounds interesting, come along with us on this journey, because you never know what you might find. We release a new episode every Tuesday morning. That's Polyphonic Press, and we're available on every podcast platform.
Sweet. Check them out. Back to Six Picks. We're looking ahead. And as we look ahead, Russ, what is the next track that you're going to help us cool things down, chill us out, make us feeling like the world's not on fire, or that it's finally just ready for us to live on again?
My next pick is called Middle Earth by Ceschi. off the Sad Fat Luck album from 2019.
Plus wasn't made for these times. Realize I will never blow up and that's fine. I'm not Cobain or Cornell or Lane. I'm just floating inside my own lane. Every word that I'm singing is plain. Just hoping that someone out there can relate. And there's times when I hate my brain. When I drive directly into trees. Think of 6 million ways to stop breathing. But my heart is pounding from the anxiety. Every year it gets sadder and fatter. To the point that you realize none of it matters much. For the minutes we have on this planet, we're seeking love. And that's more than enough. Call it what you want, call it God, call it your freedom. That connection between living beings is a powerful thing. And that's real to us. Slipping my way through the cracks, slipping my way through the
Love that. That's a good, that's a cool song, man.
That song, man, I love it. But it is a bit of a double-edged sword, right? Like, it's bittersweet all the way through. First off, though, the music, the melody, the flows, like, I just can't get enough of it. God, like, it just speaks to me for some reason. Just straight off the bat. First time I heard it. I heard it the first time with my son. We were in the car and listening to some random playlist, just looking for something new, and it came on. I was like, what is this? And he was like, this is great. And we were just like, it was like this kind of fun bonding moment. We were coming back from soccer or something, I think.
Dude, I'm kind of jealous that, like, your kids are so open just to, like, listen to stuff that they don't know. Like, mine are very, hey, let's play this song that, I mean, they're kind of open to it. Like, I'm like, I'm have you heard Pearl Jam before? You're at Soundgarden before. I'm playing my old stuff, like the dad in that movie.
This is 40.
Right, yeah. It's like, oh, I wish one of you had a dick.
Now, and he puts on Rooster by Alice in Chains. He's like, just listen. It's like, ooh. Right. It's a perfect song for that.
And they're like, how about the new Chaperone? Can we please do that? Or can we do anything that's not, you know, this? I'm like, oh, right. Sure, whatever you want.
I mean, they ask for stuff.
Maybe you're just better at setting boundaries.
Oh, yeah, I definitely, I'm like, I said, we're like, they're like, can we hear the song or whatever? I'm like, well, we're on a playlist right now. We're just going to play through and keep it. They're like, okay. And so we just like, we'll listen to a lot of new stuff.
I'll sometimes lie and be like, this is the radio. So I don't have control over it. And it's really my phone still, but, or it is the radio. Just to head that shit off.
Yeah. Your kids are still young enough that you can straight up lie fools. To them. Mine are. Yeah.
Kids are so stupid.
Mine are sentient now. Yeah. No, but keep going, Russ. Sorry. I'm just jealous of like your kids' appetite for new music.
All right, so no, it's fine. But again, like my wife was saying, you know, our kids are like, they don't have a broad range because all they listen to is like the same music you listen to. And I was like, man, I have a pretty broad range of music that we listen to. I was like, they're going to always know popular music. That will always be around. They will always know it. Like, so now
You can't escape it.
Like, yeah. I don't listen to it actively ever, but I know a lot of it because it's just everywhere. Anyway, so I just like...
Yeah, as much as I tried to keep Imagine Dragons out of my home, like, it came home from preschool, and I didn't have any control over that.
Oh, yeah.
And I...
Right.
It was the first moment where I was like, we don't listen to that here in this house. We're not playing that.
That's the devil, and we don't invite the devil into our house.
No, the vampires can't come in if you don't give them permission. Just keep them outside.
So in my first song, Grand Optimist, gets chilled me out. And then this song, Middle Earth, continues that journey and leaves me feeling better.
I was going to say, yeah.
Yeah, those two songs work kind of as a 1-2 punch to get me leveled and centered.
To ramp you up a little bit. Yeah. Kind of like get you on your way. It's like, right. It's the slap on the ass. Go get him, Tiger. You know, go in. You're in the game now, bud.
And I know I say this shit all the time, but I mean, this fucking song is vulnerable and authentic. It is. It is. I just.
Helpful, kind, hardworking.
Yeah.
You've got these artists laying out what their life ambitions were, contrasted with like how they turned out. But they haven't given up. They're still fighting. They're still creating. They're still working hard, burning the candle at both ends, no matter if they blow up or not. I fucking love it. It's just like, it's very inspirational to me. And then you've got Ceschi talking about how he wanted to be a grunge singer as a kid. And then now he knows he'll never be Layne Staley or Kurt Cobain or Chris Cornell. But he's come to terms with it after some pretty dark things happen in the song, you know, like, and then he's operating in the middle and he's not making too many waves. And then he kind of just like ties in how we're all just seeking love. And in the end, that's where it's at, right? Which is like, I think I have to agree with. So it's like, you know, I won't blow up, but in the end, if we can find love, then that's probably what we're all looking for anyway.
So when I was in grad school, I did this project where we looked at these wicked problems, problems that can't be solved. You know, it's like every solution, it's a hydra, creates another, you know, problem or whatever. And one of the problems that I, you know, worked on for my thesis was homelessness, right? And being unhoused. And there's an organization here in Austin called Community First, and they have this theory that the reason that people are unhoused is because of a traumatic loss of community, a traumatic loss of family. And so their whole mission is to create a space where people can, you know, live and have dignified income and, you know, have access to care and all the things. And it's not dependent on being, you know, sober or clean living or anything. It's just all it depends on is you being part of a community. And there's something that's so intense about this idea of being connected with people and, you know, something that's been really divisive in the last 15 years with the advent of cell phones and social media and all the stuff that we talked about with that Arcade Fire track. It's just like, it's, you know, maybe it was prolific that they were seeing the end of things and the disconnect of things. And, you know, Jeffro, you've talked a number of times about like being together, but on our phones kind of deal. It's like, why are we not engaged with each other? How are you not driving our community and promoting each other and just like being human beings? And, I hear that a lot in this, you know?
I also really respond to his solution. He's like, I'm not going to blow up. And his solution is like, I'm going to just try to find love and keep grinding away at the thing that I enjoy doing. That's creation for creation's sake.
Right.
That is like basically my answer too. I know that sounds whatever, but like I've...
No, but that was your St. Vincent show this week or whatever. You know, it's like it's this community, I think. I think it's people exploring new ideas. It's people being open to things. I don't know.
Yeah, people being open to things and make stuff.
And making things. Yeah, I mean, creation is important.
Do projects.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
It's huge.
Like, I always have projects going on myself, just for me. No, mm-hmm. Never, yeah. Anything ever really happens. You know, I mean, I'm always doing something because that is kind of what makes me happy and what helps pull me out. And so I just really relate to this song of like, well, are any of my projects going to amount to anything? Probably not. But I do love doing it. It always puts me in kind of a good mood. And then, you know, I feel like it just enriches my life for whatever reason. I mean, either I'm learning something new or I'm learning how to do something differently or whatever it may be. It's pretty great.
I feel like we in the U.S. have this thing, and it exists elsewhere too, but I think hugely in the U.S. of, you're judged by an audience of everyone. And if you can rise to the top, then it proves that your art or whatever you were creating was worthwhile.
Oh, yeah. The social capital of things. Yeah.
Fame is what the true judge of art. But I feel like when I go to other places, there are people that like have hobbies or they're just do something by themselves more. And they're like, hey, yeah, I made that table. I like making tables. And you're like, wow, that's fucking great. And you realize that those, for a lot of other people in other cultures, those are just practices of the self. And they're perfectly content with just, they like to whittle or birdwatch on their own. And that's a fulfilling way to spend their time. And it makes them feel good. And that is 100% enough for them. And we need a healthy dose of that.
I mean, this podcast, exactly. Like, we'll never be Michael Barbaro and we will not see you tomorrow. We're a bi-weekly podcast. Like, this is not the daily. Like, we're not doing this for anything other than just like we enjoy talking about music and like talking to each other.
Yeah, we're doing it to hang out. But also, I was thinking about another benefit of this thing, however long it lasts and whatever, it will always have it. And so, like, like 25 years from now, if you want to go, fuck, dude, I'm going to go listen to what we were bullshitting about when we were 40-somethings, you know, for fun. Like, what a cool thing.
Yeah, no, I mean, we have, like, documentation. We have documentation of who we were and what we were doing. Yeah, it's cool.
Exactly. It's an archive.
Right, right. No, our kids are gonna grow up and they're gonna be able to listen to like what kind of people we were when we were 40, and then they're gonna say, like, why are you voting conservative now? You were so liberal.
Yeah. Why are you obsessed with
social security now?
Why are you obsessed with World War II documentaries on the History Channel? Just go play by yourself. Leave it. Go call your friends on your phone.
Go put on your augmented reality glasses and stop messing with my actual reality. I'm not here to dehydrate pizza with you. I want to make a real pizza in a real oven.
I don't know. Why don't you go hot dogging in your hovercraft and get out of here?
Are you just going to teleport to the thing? Go on.
Oh,
then.
Sure.
You know how to ride a bike?
We're going to be so curmudgeon-y. I can't wait.
God, I hope not.
That's so really funny, dude. That's such a funny bit. Just future dad who's still just a 70s dad smoking Marlboro Reds.
It's like... it's like you can't escape it. All right, I'll finish up. I'm almost done here. So kind of by the end of it, he's saying that she doesn't love him back, either like the rap game or the lady. And so he's still got work to do, right? And while that's a bit of a downer, you got this verse by Samus that comes in, who's also a middle tier rapper, with this like fucking great verse that is so well written, and it's filled with like the middle theme, the theme of middle, if you will, just running through the whole thing. And it ends her verse saying that she may not be the biggest thing out there, but to her greatest fan, she's fucking Joan of Arc. And it just makes me think, like, if I work really hard at it, I could be Joan of Arc to my family if I wanted, right? Which puts a big smile on my face and I'm ready to do it all over again just because, like, fuck yeah, dude, like, that's it. Or going back to what you were saying with the podcast, like, we do it because we love it. We're not getting famous, but someone out there may just love it so much that we might be somebody's favorite podcast out there. And that's kind of a cool idea too. Like, you think, yeah, maybe that person hasn't heard us yet, but maybe we're somebody's favorite podcast, which would be kind of cool in its own right.
No, I've got a family relative who started a podcast after listening to our podcast. We were an inspiration to him, and AP English Literature. It's a bunch of 18-year-old kids talking about poems they read in AP English Literature and then other nonsense they get into. So
that's awesome. That's a great idea. I'm going to listen to that. That's genius.
Go check out AP English Literature.
It's just some kids talking poetry. Fuck yeah, dude. Sign me up.
They start with poetry and then they delve off. You know, they find other avenues. And
dude,
it's,
I love that.
You know.
I'm gonna go listen to whatever.
I'm super proud of them. Yeah. And you know, they're great. They're great.
Can I
kids.
Get it wherever I get podcasts?
You can definitely get it on Spotify. I don't know if you can get it everywhere you get your podcasts, but check it out on Spotify. But they're a little more highbrow than we are, and they certainly do not talk about methamphetamine like we do, because they're 18.
Well, they just haven't had life hit them hard enough yet, that's all.
That's great. It's basically like all the kids from Dead Poets Society, and then they're like, you know, they're all just so serious.
Yeah, I don't know that we inspired them so much as they heard this and they're like, oh God, that's terrible. Yeah. We can do way better than that.
They're like, there are low barriers to entry on this thing. Like,
oh shit, that's all it takes? Yeah. Let's
if
go.
They could do it. Like, they're like, if they could do it, we can, boys. Like, they have that old, like, Northeast accent. Mm-hmm. That's not a British accent, mm-hmm. but it's not really American either. It's like, yes, let's go talk about poetry, boys.
That's what Maryland does, man.
That's more Southern California. Anyways, less songs to me. And so I've got another one that I feel like follows the second half of the show a little bit, in that, like, we are looking forward. We are, like, thinking about things that are possible, and we're not going to be stuck in today. We're going to think about what's next. You know, like, we're not going to get mired down in this moment, because, you know, like, whether we're happy or sad, it's just a day. It's just a feeling, and tomorrow's a new day. We're going to listen to 7/4 parenthetically Shoreline by a broken social scene off of their self-titled record from October 4th of 2005.
Another Canadian band, love this band. Good song. It feels like an end of the day song, you know, so you're like kind of,
yeah,
we've had mourning, we've renewed, we've reconnected, we've come to terms with our search for love, and now we're like, now it's like time to zone out a little, like ultimate chill day.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think for me, this is there's something that's pretty powerful around the song structure. I mean, obviously, there's an unconventional time structure to the song, being in seven quarters, which is fairly unusual. But I think what the song does is it creates this sort of anticipation. There's like there's a tension that's created because it's out of time. It's always building and growing, kind of like a Hans Zimmer score. I think lyrically, it's there's a little bit of ambiguity. There's some abstractness and it's open to interpretation, but I think there's also themes of like nostalgia, the passage of time. You know, just like there's a connection to this place and time that's specific and also like trying to find a way to something that's more comfortable, more natural, more ourselves, more where it wants to be. It's like it's a growth song for me. You know, if you've ever seen this band live, this is typically one of the last songs they play in their set, because it is such a dynamic track and how it evolves from, you know, being calming and easy to big and loud and dynamic. It's a pretty powerful one. First time I saw this band was, I think, in 2008 or 9. They were opening up the Bass Concert Hall where I was working as a stage manager, and this was the opening band for that concert, and one of the opening bands for that season. And that day I was the driver, so I got to drive the band around, and I was with their manager and trying to find like kombucha and stuff, because Kevin Drew, their lead singer, was all sick and just like he'd partied too hard the night before, and she was like, "Well, we gotta get him some healthy stuff." So we just drove all around to Whole Foods and Central Market and where's all the granola stuff, and I remember him like deep throating a banana in the green room, like as a joke, but then choking on it and said, "What the fuck did I do that for?" But anyway, it was a great experience.
That's funny.
And this was a really powerful like thing to watch from the side of the stage and just like, holy shit, because I'd never seen this band before. I'd never like really heard of them before. Other people had told me, "Oh yeah, I like that band a lot. That would be cool to go see them." And then like from that moment, like I like went to the merch table in the lobby while the show was going on, and I bought, you know, I was like, "Give me those vinyl, give me this poster, give me this stuff." Like, this has made me a fan for life. And this track in particular, it's one that just explodes, and it's sort of like, it feels like there's new life, that there is opportunity, and that we will continue to grow. We'll continue forward. Like, this is not the end. This is a new day. And like, we started with the new day of like, let's all be cool and relax. And this is where we end the day, saying like, we've got a plan and we're moving forward with conviction, and we're doing it strong, and there's nothing that's going to hold us back. We won't be stopped.
Yeah, man.
It relaxes me and it fires me up, you know, because I love this song.
That's awesome.
Well, hey, listener, we really hope that these songs can help you get through the day today. If you're celebrating, good for you. If you're heartbroken or frantically trying to renew your passport, I know a guy in Canada who can offer you asylum, maybe.
I got a basement. I got a basement for roughly 3 million people that want to move here.
Unless you like songs from 1999, which does actually bring us to our inbox this week. Our listener listening email from this week is from Mike J. in Kansas City, and he writes, So in 1999, Tom Waits released Mule Variations.
Oh, that's a good record.
Beck released Midnight Vultures.
Oh, man.
Rage Against the Machine released Battle of Los Angeles. Flaming Lips, The Soft Bulletin, and fucking Nine Inch Nails released The Fragile. I thought Geoff and his wife were big Nails fans. Am I wrong? Are they fake fans, or is it just him? Anyways, so many of the records that came out in 99 were instrumental, not just for me, but to the entire future of rock music and cannot be dismissed. I guess everyone's entitled to their opinion, even if they're patently wrong. Anyways, give this track, Lonsdale Slip-Ons, a listen. It's by The Bug Club. So, dang, Jeffro, you got put on notice there a little bit.
You know what I mean, dude? It's a heavily worded email, and it didn't have to be. But I'm going to admit that the man is right, you know? Those are all great records. And I will stand down.
Yeah.
The rest of all of the, those were, I would still say, are the diamonds that were mixed in with a tremendous amount of poo-poo. But there were diamonds nonetheless, Mike J. Granted.
Yeah. Yeah, thanks, Mike. We will give the Bug Club a listen and...
Wait, it's called the Butt Club?
The Bug Club, I guess, is the band.
Oh, man, the Butt Club would be a way better name for that band that I've never heard.
Well, let's see if we can't find them on Instagram and, you know, give them a follow and shoot them a DM and let them know that their band name should be changed to the Butt Club. Thank you, Penis Sauce, Jeffro. My God. Well, Mike, say it louder for the people in the back. We'll give that Bug Club a listen, and we'll see you guys next time, listener. Thanks for showing up, and until then, we just play it loud. Keep jamming.
Stay calm, stay cool.
This episode of Six Picks Music Club was produced by Dean Goldberry.
Dean Goldberry.
I don't know that Dean is his first name. I think that's his position. I think he's like, he's a, you know, at a college.
Dean of Liberal Arts. The Dean of the College of Liberal Arts, Dean Goldberry.
Dean Goldberry.
Edited by Jenna Tolles. With special thanks to Dixie Wrecked. Call the police.